Good evening, everyone. My name is Natalie Loney. I'm the Community Involvement Coordinator with the Environmental Protection Agency, and with me is Walter Mugden. Walter is the head of the Superfund Division in EPA Region 2. In the front row here is Christos Tsiamis. Christos is the Remedial Project Manager on the Superfund site, and next to Christos is Tom Lieber. Tom is one of the site attorneys. The purpose of tonight's meeting, we're having a public meeting on the proposed settlement agreement and order regarding the design and site preparation for RH-034, which is at the head of the canal. This is a public meeting, and as such, we have a stenographer here recording, so there will be an opportunity after the presentation for question and answer. This is the working microphone, so if you have a question or a comment, we'll be passing around a notepad for your name to be placed on it, and we'll be calling out names accordingly. And you'll have to come to this side of the room to, the microphone doesn't stretch that far. So I'd ask that you come to this side of the room to ask your question or make your statement. And because of the number of people and the limited amount of time, we would ask that you limit your comment to about 3 minutes maximum. Right, so I'm going to turn the microphone over to Walter Mugden for the presentation, after which will be the question and answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Natalie. And as Natalie said, the structure of this meeting is a little different than some of the other meetings that I've been at with respect to the Gowanus Canal. The real purpose today is to hear from you. I'm going to give a short presentation about the settlement agreement and order that EPA proposes to enter into with the City of New York. The comment period opened on April 14th when we announced this proposed agreement. The comment period extends to May 16th. You're certainly invited to make comments here this evening, as Natalie said, but you're also encouraged and invited to make written comments, and at the end of the presentation on the screen we'll have my mailing address and my email address to which the where the comments can be directed. So again, we apologize for the small screen. The school had indicated that they would be able to bring the large screen down, but they weren't able to do so. So if you are having any difficulty seeing it, please feel free to move down closer to the front of the auditorium. As Natalie said, the purpose is to talk about the proposed EPA administrative settlement agreement and order regarding the siting, design, and site preparation for the RH-034 combined sewer overflow retention tank. Let me see if I can move through here now. So just very briefly to remind you of the project history, most of you have lived it, so I'll just run through this quickly. The Gowanus Canal was placed on the national priorities list of Superfund sites in March of 2010. Our first major step after that was to complete the remedial investigation to determine the nature and extent of contamination. That was completed by January 2011. I know it may not feel that way to you, but the dates that you see in here, the sequence of events, were actually quite quick by Superfund terms. The next step after that was the feasibility study, in which we evaluated various engineering options for addressing the problems that had been identified in the remedial investigation. That was completed in December of 2011. Thereafter, we came forward again to the community in a meeting such as this, that was on the record, with a proposed cleanup plan. That was in December of 2012. Then we took public comment and got a great deal of comment, and evaluated those comments and prepared a detailed responsiveness summary, and we came up with our final decision in a document called the Record of Decision, and you'll see that abbreviated as ROD or ROD as we go through the presentation. That was in late September 2013. The next working day after that ROD was issued, the government was shut down for 2 weeks. Then after that, we initiated discussions with the various responsible parties, or as we courteously call them, potentially responsible parties, and you may hear that abbreviated as PRPs, and we entered into discussions with them to request that they agree to carry out the remedial design. That's the actual design of how the work called for in the ROD would be carried out. We were not able to reach consensual agreement at that time with the PRPs. We instead, in early 2014, spring of 2014, we issued two what we call unilateral administrative orders. The word unilateral simply means that it's not on consent, it's just simply EPA issuing an order to the responsible parties, directing them to carry out certain steps. Last year, in the spring and summer of 2015, EPA carried out a pilot project to evaluate the success of something called in situ sediment stabilization, which is a way of solidifying the mucky sediment at the bottom of the canal, the contaminated native sediments there, to actually concretize them. That project was successful. Next slide. So again, as a reminder, most of you are very, very familiar with this. This is an aerial photograph of this section of Brooklyn showing the Gowanus Canal project area circled in red. You see there in the yellow line, that's the flushing tunnel that comes in at the head of canal and brings fresh water from buttermilk channel to the head of the canal. Butternut, buttermilk.
I like that better.
Something that you would eat. Next slide, please. I'll get off that one. So, as I said, we issued the Record of Decision, or ROD, in September of 2013. It required, had certain elements that it required. It basically selected dredging and capping with in situ stabilization of certain sediments in the canal. And the cap itself was going to be a three-layer cap that fulfills various objectives. The remedy also includes excavation of the First Street turning basin, one of the turning basins that was built into the canal originally but had been subsequently filled in. And the ROD also calls for or depends upon source controls. Source in this case simply means the source of the contamination that has entered the canal historically or that is continuing today to enter into the canal. Chief among those are three former manufactured gas plants, or MGPs. These were plants where in the 19th to 20th centuries, coal was turned into gas for gas lighting and things of that sort. These three facilities and others like them all around the country left behind a residue called coal tar, which is heavily contaminated with polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons, or PAHs, and that is one of the chief contaminants in the canal, by no means the only one, but certainly probably the most ubiquitous and in the highest concentrations. The actual cleanup of the MGP sites themselves is under the jurisdiction of the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation, or NYC DEP. Our ROD took into account that these MGPs would be cleaned up in certain ways to limit or minimize the amount of coal tar that continues to enter into the canal. Obviously, we don't want to clean up the canal only to have it be recontaminated. And that brings us to the last bullet there under source controls, CSOs, combined sewer overflows. Older sewage systems like that in New York and many other older cities were designed intentionally with a single pipe carrying both the sewage from homes and businesses, from toilets, from sinks, and so forth. And the same pipe would also carry the rainwater when it rains. And the pipes and the treatment plants at the end of the pipes were designed to be big enough to manage the sewage, but they were nowhere near big enough to manage the sewage plus rainwater when it rains. So these systems were designed that at low points, near the harbors and rivers and bays, there was an overflow, and when it would rain over a certain amount, the pipe was full, then the excess sewage and rainwater mixture would go into the nearest waterway. And there were a number of those CSO discharge points along the length, the 2 mile length of the Gowanus Canal. Several of them have already been addressed, diverted in some other ways. There are still two very significant ones or larger ones. One is known as OH-007, sort of in the middle of the canal, and the other one is the RH-034 discharge point that you saw in the title of our presentation here, and that's at the very, very head end of the canal. We also, in the ROD, called for something called institutional controls, recognizing that even with all this other work, there will be, this will not be pristine water, and one of the institutional controls is to remain in place fish advisories, advising people not to eat or consume the fish or crabs caught in the canal. And we anticipate that those will have to stay in place for some time. Next slide. Again, this is a map showing the location of the former MGPs, the manufactured gas plants, and the various CSO discharge points. A little hard to see. Down near the bottom end of the canal was the Metropolitan, former MGP. That's now the site of the Lowe's. In the middle was the Citizens Gas Works. That's the future site of what's called Public Place. And at the head end up there was the Fulton, former MGP. Part of that was directly underneath the swimming pool of the Thomas Green Park. And other portions were a little closer to the canal, or right adjacent to the canal, and a little bit south of, I guess it's DeGraw Street. Is that the southerly of the two streets, of the two D's? A little south of DeGraw Street was another major source of coal tar contamination. And again, the little blue numbers that you see along the way here are the numbers that designate these CSO discharge points. You see there's quite a few of them, but the two that I mentioned earlier are the real large ones, and those are the ones that we've primarily been focusing on. Next slide. So again, as I mentioned, the former MGPs are being addressed and evaluated by the New York State DEC. For the Fulton manufactured gas plant site, the one at the head of the canal, the remedy that the state has called for there requires a cutoff wall to be installed between the land and the canal, basically right along the boundary of the canal. That cutoff wall will be made out of sheet piling and will go very, very deep into the ground, and the piles will be sealed one to the next one, and the purpose there is to block the flow of coal tar from the land into the canal. Another element is the removal of major mobile coal tar sources, and the state calls for this to be done when a property is redeveloped. So the state, as a matter of general approach to MGP plants that were all over the place, doesn't require ordinarily that existing buildings be torn down as soon as the state reaches a remedy decision so that the ground can be dug up and the coal tar can be removed. What the state typically does is they say when the time comes that the current property owner or future property owner wants to redevelop anyhow, that is the moment when the responsible party has to go in and remove the coal tar contamination to certain depths when it appears at certain levels. And in this case, the state would also require, has also required, what are called recovery wells to be placed alongside and inboard, landward, of the cutoff wall. These are wells placed into the ground into which the coal tar can seep, and then it can be removed, it can be bailed out or pumped out from those wells. Such wells already exist, for example, on the Lowe's property where one of those MGPs was located. EPA has decided that we're going to require removal of coal tar contaminated soil from, among other locations, beneath the Thomas Green Park. As I said, under the state record of decision for the Fulton MGP site, the state would not call for that to happen until and unless there was going to be redevelopment or reconstruction or some other kind of restoration of the park. And but for our decision here, that might be quite a number of years. Our objective is to get that heavy concentration of coal tar that is beneath the swimming pool portion of the Thomas Green Park, that's the western portion of the property, We need to get that out because that is an ongoing, continuing source of coal tar contamination moving westward through the ground, underground, and into and below the canal. So we're going to require that work to be done. The entity responsible, legally responsible, for the coal tar contamination associated with these three MGP sites, plants, is National Grid. National Grid wasn't around when these manufactured gas plants were operating. What happened is the manufactured gas plants were in the early 1900s. All of them were separate companies. They were assembled into a single company called Brooklyn Union Gas, the union of all these different companies. BUG, as it was known to anybody in Brooklyn. BUG was bought in the early 1990s by Keyspan. So Keyspan inherited the legal liability for those manufactured gas plants. And National Grid purchased Keyspan in the early 2000s. So National Grid owns the legal liability for the manufactured gas plants that operated many, many decades ago. We're going to require that coal tar removal to take place under the park in any event. Next slide. As I mentioned at the outset, we are also in the record of decision, we also called for CSOs to be controlled, specifically these two large discharge points, 007 and 034. The picture on above is the famous YouTube video of the Poonami, as it is called. You can see a line of brownish sludge moving down from the head of canal. This is during a rainstorm, and as the rain came on very suddenly, the pipes are overwhelmed, and this combination of rainwater and sewage comes out into the canal and moves downstream with it. Over the years, these combined sewer overflows have also deposited a lot of solids, a lot of sediment, and near the discharge points. This comes out of the sewers. It's sewage, it's leaves and whatever else, debris might be on the streets that get into the pipes when it rains. And they have created sediment mounds where those discharge points are located so that at low tide, some of those mounds are actually above the surface of the water, and therefore they create a very noxious odor. Next slide. So as I mentioned, source controls was an important part of the record of decision. Clearly, the most dominant source of ongoing contamination to the canal are those three former manufactured gas plant sites. Until they're controlled, coal tar continues to move from the land into the canal. However, our concern is that once we have asked National Grid and other responsible parties to spend a great deal of money, close to $500 million, to clean up the canal, we don't want it to get recontaminated even by relatively lower levels of ongoing contamination. The CSO discharges do carry with them lower, but still of significance, lower levels of PAH contamination, as well as other contaminants. So for that reason, in order to protect the integrity of the remedy that otherwise we were calling for in the canal itself, we needed to control the sources, the main big sources of the coal tar, but also the anticipated future continued sources of CSO discharge. So when we wrote the record of decision, we said we were calling for what are called inline retention tanks at those two discharge locations that I've named earlier. We assumed that the 007 CSO discharge point would have a 4 million gallon retention tank, and that it would be located on the sanitation department lot, the salt storage lot site, which is about in the middle of the canal. And for RH-034, the discharge point at the head of canal, we assumed an 8 million gallon tank located on the west side of Thomas Green Park. We identified that as a plausible location for the RH-034 tank. We called it a potentially suitable location because of synergies between the anticipated need to excavate underneath the swimming pool anyhow in order to remove the coal tar contaminated soil that's there. So as we were thinking about writing the record of decision, we said to ourselves, we're going to have to disrupt the park anyhow to get the coal tar contaminated soil out. The city owns the property. It seems like a plausible location for a tank to be placed. We assumed it was going to be placed there. The tank locations were going, according to the record of decision, the tank locations would be finalized during the design phase, and that's what brings us here tonight. Next slide. So, for 007, the 4 million gallon tank, and by the way, let me just say parenthetically, an important parenthetical, is that we, EPA, have now decided that the size of these two tanks will be 4 million gallons and 8 million gallons, as the ROD assumed. We had discussions with the city of New York about that. There were some arguments that perhaps they could be smaller. There were some questions about whether they needed to be larger. We have concluded, after careful evaluation, that those sizes that we assumed in the record of decision are appropriate, and that's one of the decisions we've now made. As I said, for 007, there really ends up being no dispute about the location. But for 034, two different locations were ultimately in contest. So here in this chart, you see where on 007 the location is. It's this triangular piece of property. It's right where the canal takes a sort of an S bend, sort of in the middle of the canal. And for 034, in the lower photograph, diagram there, the map, you see the crosshatched area overlaid above the Thomas Green Park. That was the site that we assumed in the record of decision for planning purposes and so on would be where that tank would go. Next slide. So in the 2014 unilateral administrative orders that we issued one of those two orders was issued to the City of New York and covered design and site selection for the CSO tanks. It also covered design of the excavation of the First Street turning basin. But as to evaluating sites, we directed the city to go through an evaluation and to report by June 30th, 2015 on what sites the city proposes for these two tanks. As I said, for 007, the city did propose the sanitation department salt storage lot, and that is the same location that we had assumed. And the design of that tank for that location will continue under the unilateral administrative order. That's not affected by the settlement agreement and order that we are proposing now and taking public comment on. For RH-034, the city proposed what is called the head of canal location. That's on Nevin Street between Butler and DeGraw. It's essentially, it's immediately adjacent to the canal, right at the head of canal. Next slide. So the city was proposing a site that was different from the one that we had assumed. We then started to very carefully consider the pros and cons, the benefits and drawbacks of these two alternative sites, the park site that we had assumed in the record of decision, and the head of canal site that the city said it strongly preferred. We've had a couple of meetings at which the public was invited to be present, and many, many members were present, in which we discussed these issues. First was on October 26th, 2015. It was a community board 6 meeting. I was there, spent about an hour and a half discussing some of these benefits and drawbacks that we saw and what kinds of evaluation EPA was carrying out. And then on January 19th of this year, I also attended a meeting of the community advisory board, a group, the CAG, and spoke there. And again, there were many members of the CAG there, but also other members of the public were present. And of course, we have had extensive discussions and, as is evident from the proposed order, detailed negotiations with the City of New York. We've also consulted with our partners in the New York State DEC about the tank siting. Next slide. So again, this is an aerial photograph of the head of canal area. The two yellow outlines are the two sites that are sort of that have been in contention for the larger of the two tanks. The 8 million gallon tank. On the lower half of the L, if you call it an L, there is the park location basically right underneath where the pool was is one of the major sources of coal tar, as we mentioned earlier. But that yellow outline is about the size that would be necessary for an 8 million gallon tank. And the vertical part of the L represents two privately owned parcels. Each one is about half that rectangle in size. And that would be the head of canal location that the city has strongly advocated. And we'll come back to that photograph later on. In fact, we'll probably have it up during the public comment portion of the meeting tonight. So if anybody wants to ask questions about it or allude to it, you'll see it again. Next slide. So these are things that I've said in the previous two meetings that I mentioned to you, and we've said it in other documents that are in part of the administrative record. EPA believed and continues to believe that construction of the RH-034 tank at the park location could be done more quickly, more easily, and at less expense than the head of canal location. But EPA also understands the city's strong policy reasons for avoiding a longer than necessary disruption and the potential permanent loss of space at the Thomas Green Park site if the tank were placed there and the city plans associated with the tank something called a head house, which is an above ground structure that has various equipment in it, including air cleaning equipment to prevent odors and so forth. And the city felt that if the tank were going to be placed into the park, then the head house would be right above it in the park and would occupy permanently a segment of space in the park. After considerable discussion and back and forth, EPA advised the city, and this was in late October of 2015, that we would be prepared to accept the head of canal location under certain conditions. And one of those conditions was that the city enter into an administrative consent settlement with EPA for the design and certain site preparation work associated with its preferred site, well, actually with both sites, as I'll explain in a minute, that this consent agreement or settlement agreement would replace the unilateral administrative order for the purposes of the RH-034 tank. And for reasons that I'll allude to in a minute, that was an extremely important element for EPA, and we judge that to be a very valuable element. So that was one important condition. There's a few other elements of or conditions that I'll go into in just a moment, but we negotiated with the City of New York starting in November and running up until basically April 14th. On April 14th, by late March, we had come to agreement on all the words in the document. And by April 14th, we had on the document the signature of Emily Lloyd, the commissioner of the New York City Department of Environmental Protection. EPA has not yet signed or executed the administrative order. Starting with the receipt of Commissioner Lloyd's signature on the document, we then made public this proposal, and that's when we opened the public comment period. We had been asked by the Community Advisory Group to have a public comment process associated with this decision. So in response to that request, we have opened this public comment period. The order, therefore, is not yet final. It's a proposed order. EPA, I will make it very clear, we believe this is a favorable outcome for us. We are prepared to move forward with it and to proceed with it. The negotiations were extensive and tough on both sides. We believe that's a fair outcome, so we're not lightly going to walk away from it or change it. But this is your opportunity to tell us if you think we are making a mistake or that we have done something wrong, or that you have a better mousetrap. This is your opportunity to tell us, and certainly we will keep an open mind. We will carefully consider all of the comments that we receive. After the end of the comment period, we'll evaluate those and we'll make a decision. There's three basic decisions that can be made. We can proceed with the document as drafted, in which case I or whoever then sits in my chair will sign it, and it will become a final order of the EPA. Or we can propose to the City of New York changes in the document and see whether the city accepts those changes, in which case we could finalize it with changes that respond to public comments. Or we can conclude that there is no deal, and either we or the city or both of us can walk away from the deal. So those are the three possible outcomes of this public comment process. As I said, we announced the agreement on April 14th. The comment period is open until May 16th. And again, at the end, we'll give you locations or email or snail mail for your comments. Next slide. So here are the elements of the proposed agreement, the key elements. It's an extraordinarily complicated document. I think I was talking with Tom Lieber, who is the chief of the New York Superfund branch in our Office of Regional Council. And he and I have both been in this program for decades. This is as complicated an administrative order under the Superfund program as we have ever been involved in. It's extraordinarily detailed and intricate. And one of the reasons is because of the extremely high importance of actions by National Grid and actions by the City of New York to be coordinated. And that is a challenging prospect, but it's absolutely essential for the success of this. By the way, it's important irrespective of the location of the tank. It is probably even more important for the city's proposed location at the head of the canal. Anyhow, here's what the agreement involves. This agreement identifies the head of canal location for the RH-034 tank and requires the city to design the tank for that site. But, and this was another key condition that we presented to the city, it requires the city to simultaneously design the 8 million gallon tank for the park location as a contingency. Importantly, it requires the City of New York to carry out Superfund removal activities to remove contaminated soil and to prepare the head of canal location for the tank. 8 million gallon tank is a very, very large tank. It has a large footprint. And within that footprint, the city is obliged to dig it out in order to place the tank there. And it is very likely that among the areas that they'll have to dig out, there will be coal tar contaminated soil. There may also be soil contaminated with other pollutants other than coal tar. The city is obligated under this order to remove and manage the coal tar contaminated soil and, of course, the other soil as well, even though National Grid is legally responsible for the coal tar contaminated soil. The reason for this distinction is that within the footprint of the tank, it's essential, in our judgment, that the City of New York, which is going to build the tank, has to have control over the perimeter of the tank and the hole that's going to be dug within it. You can't have somebody else's contractor coming in there and digging out the soil to try and create the hole into which the city's tank will go. So the costs of this, as between the city and National Grid, will be probably worked out in some way that we don't necessarily need to be part of, but National Grid may have to pay the costs of dealing with coal tar contaminated soil, but it'll be the city contractors and the city's legal responsibility under this agreement to do the work within the footprint of the tank. Outside the footprint of the tank, because the tank will not cover the entire two parcels that we've talked about. Outside the footprint of the tank, any coal tar contaminated soil that is necessary to remove under the state's record of decision, that'll be done by National Grid. And it has to be done first. So this is where I said the sequencing becomes important. So the first step is that National Grid digs out the soil that's contaminated with coal tar outside the footprint of the tank. The second step is that the city has to dig out the contaminated soil and any other soil inside the footprint of the tank. So that's the Superfund removal activities that are called for under this order. So it goes beyond just the design functions, it carries out these site preparation functions. Second to last bullet there, the order establishes a schedule for the property acquisition that the city has to carry out. As I said, these are privately owned parcels. The city has to acquire title to those in some manner, and there's various ways that could happen, but the city has got to do it. And that includes the city going through what's called the ULURP process. Let's see if I get this right. Uniform Land Use Regulatory Process, I believe is what it stands for.
Review.
I'm sorry, the R is review. I beg your pardon. Thank you. And also the environmental review process under the City Environmental Quality Review Act, or SEQR. Under this order, this agreement that we've negotiated, the acquisition must occur by April 2020. That's a long time. That's 4 years away. As I said, we recognize that this process of going to the head of canal location will, in our judgment, take longer than if we went to the park location. The city has countered and said, even at the park location, the city believes it would need to go through the ULURP and SEQR processes, and moreover, the city felt that it would probably have to go through what's called a parkland alienation process, which requires going to the state legislature and asking the state legislature to approve the change of use, either temporarily or permanently, of parkland to some other use or some secondary use. EPA didn't necessarily agree, as a matter of law, with the city's conclusion on that, but EPA did acknowledge that this created a series of uncertainties and even the possibility of litigation at the park site, just as we know that these processes have to be carried out at the head of canal location. So although we believe and continue to believe that the park location could be done faster, we recognize that there was a considerable amount of uncertainty and the possibility for litigation. Nevertheless, the order also says that if the city fails to meet specified scheduled events, we call them milestones, on the way from here, now, to April 2020, then EPA may require the city to pivot. That's the word we kind of invented for this process, to pivot from the head of canal location to the park location. And it is to protect the schedule for that possibility that we have asked, or required rather, that both designs be carried out simultaneously. So if a pivot is necessary at some point, then one doesn't lose a great deal of time. We still lose some amount of time probably, but not a great deal of time. Next slide. So, as I alluded to, the scheduled dates for some of the New York City obligations under this proposed agreement follow actions that are going to be taken by National Grid that are related to its obligations to remove coal tar contaminated soil. And that's true for both locations. As I said, there's coal tar contaminated soil in both locations, and so Grid will have obligations at both locations. So Grid has to do its work first before the city steps in and picks up its work. EPA's expectation and intention is that we will enter into an administrative order with National Grid that will require these removal actions, this removal work, to be taken at both locations. In this agreement that we're here talking about tonight, the city is obligated to cooperate and coordinate with National Grid in Grid's performance of that work, including, importantly, the siting and creation of a temporary pool and associated facilities that will have to be built and operated, built before the existing pool starts to be dismantled. We will insist and ensure that a temporary replacement pool exists before the current existing pool is dismantled. That pool then has to be dismantled, and the coal tar contaminated soil has to come out from below the pool area. Assuming that the tank doesn't pivot back to the park location, and that the tank is built as planned now at the head of canal location, then it'll be Grid's obligation to to rebuild the pool or to work with the city to rebuild the pool, actually that obligation will exist in either circumstance. Because even if the tank were placed at the pool location, the likely outcome would be that a pool might then be placed above the tank. So grid has to create a temporary pool and then has to participate in or pay for or assist in the creation of a new pool after the work is completed. The city and National Grid, as I said, will share responsibility for the removal work at the head of canal location. This is what I was talking about a moment ago. Grid will do the work outside the footprint of the tank. The city will do the work inside the footprint of the tank. Next slide. So the proposed agreement does memorialize, for the first time, New York City's commitment. Actually, I'm jumping ahead of myself, I'm sorry. What I wanted to say here is it memorializes the city commitment to a future settlement to perform maintenance dredging if deemed necessary to remove any CSO-related sediments, contaminated sediments, that accumulate after the canal remedy is put in place, but before the CSO tank is constructed. Because of the schedule that now takes us through 4 more years, as much as 4 more years, it might be faster, before the tank design is completed and the acquisition of the property is carried out. And only then can the site preparation work and the CSO tank construction work begin. It's possible, even likely, very likely, that the CSO discharge will be continuing without the benefit of the tank for some period of time after the canal remedy up at the head of canal has been completed. If that causes contaminated sediments coming out of the CSO discharge to accumulate on top of the now cleaned canal, and if we judge that removal of those sediments is necessary to protect the canal remedy, the city will be obliged to do that and has committed to do that under a future settlement to be negotiated over the next years. This agreement that we're proposing here today does include what are called stipulated penalties for the city's failure to comply with certain elements of the order. Stipulated penalties are just that. They say if a certain kind of a violation or if a certain kind of non-compliance occurs, EPA can demand that the city pay a fine, a penalty. And this creates an incentive, I think a pretty strong incentive, for the city to remain on schedule once the order is put in place. That is not the case under the unilateral administrative order. Now, EPA has, under the law, very strong enforcement authorities with which we can answer a failure to comply with the unilateral administrative order. But there are also some downsides or some drawback elements to exercising those enforcement authorities. In our judgment, having a consensual agreement which involves stipulated penalties is a more desirable form of enforcement mechanism for us to utilize. The agreement also includes what we call what we consider to be a favorable dispute resolution procedure. Under any agreement, parties can differ. Parties can have disputes. And settlement agreements that EPA enters into routinely have a dispute resolution procedure. The way in which that works is the parties have a certain obligation to exchange information about a dispute. Ultimately, the dispute rises up to a particular designated official who makes a decision, and that decision is final. In this agreement, that official is whoever is sitting in the chair that I now occupy, so the Superfund Division Director of EPA Region 2. That's an expedited process. It's one that is in EPA's control to manage, and that's why we think it's favorable. Yes, there's also, you're right, thank you, but I skipped over the favorable force majeure provisions. Force majeure is a legal concept that says some kinds of noncompliance are beyond the ability of the respondent to control. And the question of what kinds of circumstances could give rise to that kind of a force majeure, which is something for which the respondent ought not to be penalized because it's beyond their control, limiting what kinds of circumstances can be considered a force majeure is important in these kinds of agreements. And again, we feel that it's a tightly negotiated provision in this administrative order, one that we consider to be favorable and satisfactory. Final bullet there, New York City agrees to reimburse EPA for our oversight costs. Our employees do not get paid a great deal, but they do have to get paid. And our contractors have to get paid. And so having the ability to receive reimbursement for those costs is an important element in making it possible for us to devote the necessary resources to this oversight process. Next slide. One of the most important elements, in my judgment, of this proposed agreement is that when it becomes effective, New York City agrees to waive its right to any legal challenge of EPA's selection of CSO controls in the 2013 Record of Decision. And that includes challenges based upon the differential of costs attributable to its choice to move to the head of canal location, which in our judgment is likely, very likely to be much more expensive than the park location. Now, the reason this is important to us is because under the Superfund law, if we were to take an enforcement action against the city or any other respondent to a unilateral administrative order, and we go to court to seek penalties or to seek what's called injunctive relief, requiring the respondent to come into compliance, pay a penalty for their violation, the respondent at that point, and only at that point, has the legal right to challenge EPA's remedy decision. That's the first and only time when a respondent can challenge an EPA remedy decision, only when we choose to enforce it against them. As you know, the inclusion of CSO controls in this Record of Decision was unprecedented. It's the first time in Superfund history, I think there's only one other instance where it's occurred, where CSO controls were included in a Superfund remedy. Normally, controls of CSOs is the province of the water pollution program for the federal and state governments. We took an unusual and at that point unprecedented step of including it in the Superfund remedy. The city of New York argued vigorously that that was inappropriate. Now, I'm confident that if we had to enforce the existing unilateral administrative order against the city of New York for some reason, I mean, I hope we wouldn't be in that position, but if we did, and we went to court to enforce it, and the city challenged the inclusion of CSO controls in the Record of Decision as being beyond the scope of the Superfund program, I am confident that we would prevail. But that's a projection. It's an informed guess. And when you go into litigation, nothing is certain. So in my judgment, one of the most important elements of getting this consensual settlement agreement is that the city agrees from now on and forever, not just during this design phase, but for the rest of this cleanup program, the city agrees to waive its right to legally challenge the CSO elements of the Record of Decision. That's a big concession on the part of the city. It turned out to be the final item that we negotiated. It was one of the conditions that were identified at the beginning of the negotiations. And by agreement among the parties, we agreed to leave it to the very last step, so that once everything else was negotiated, then we came back to that and we fought about that. And ultimately, EPA was satisfied with the outcome. This is what we got. So this is a very important reason why I am recommending to you, or commending to you, that this agreement, notwithstanding what will be disappointing to many of you here about the extended schedule, is nevertheless a very good thing that in the long run is worth the price. And the final bullet there, this agreement does reflect, for the first time, New York City's willingness to implement CSO retention tanks as an element of this Gowanus Canal cleanup. As I said, and as you all know, the city argued very vigorously that tanks were not necessary and that they certainly shouldn't be part of a Superfund cleanup. Indeed, in the long-term control plan that the city submitted to the state of New York on June 30th, 2015, CSO retention tanks are not part of that water pollution cleanup program. So only the Superfund record of decision calls for the creation of these tanks at this moment. So this is what makes it very important in our judgment that we get this settlement agreement finalized. I think that's probably the last slide.
Yeah, the last one is your comments.
Yeah, you want to go to the next slide? Because then we're going to take public comment.
I need to make a correction on the...
Okay. Got an email error in there?
Yes, let me check it.
Natalie's going to correct my email because she's got it duplicated there. On the next slide in a moment, we're going to go to the comments. And again, we're going to ask you to... Do we have a list? Is that
right? Yeah. Barry?
So Barry Shore is probably going to come down with a list. We're going to call out maybe five names at a time. We're going to ask you to come around to this side, your right aisle, because this is as far as the microphone moves.
No, don't worry about it. What we're going to do is Barry is going to come to the front of the room here. Anyone who wants to make a comment, you can just sign up. So we'll call people and name them. Don't have to get up. We'll bring the list to you.
All right, I apologize. I misunderstood how it was going to be done. So Natalie's going to get the list. We're going to bring it around. We'll get names. Once we get names, we're going to ask people to line up. We're going to give a chance to everybody to speak. We're going to ask you to try and keep yourself to about 3 minutes. I remind the members of the CAG, and I see many of you here, that I will be joining you at your meeting tomorrow night. And that's not a meeting on the record, the way this is here. There won't be a court reporter. And I'll be able at that point to have a more sort of a fluid or dynamic interchange with you. I'll be happy to try and answer questions that you may have. The structure of this meeting tonight is a little different. It's more formal. The purpose is to put your comments on the record so that we can consider them as we make our decision. When you comment, if you would please state your name, and if the reporter needs you to spell it, do you want the person to spell it? Okay.
My name is Glenn Kelly. I live two blocks from here, and I want to encourage the EPA to ignore the city's political maneuvering and rely on the science that they've used thus far, and reject this agreement. And here's why. About 6 or 7 years ago, when EPA arrived in Gowanus, no one was happier than I was at the prospect of a thorough cleanup of the canal. But there were some in the community who were skeptical, but the EPA overcame the skepticism by consistently and repeatedly demonstrating their commitment and ability to do a thorough cleanup of the canal, finally. I don't trust the city to do that, and I think what they're doing here is creating a boondoggle in making this this project far more complex and far more expensive than it needs to be. And it's just not going to work. I think they're going to make this so big that it's going to be impossible for them to finish it. So I hope that you'll stick with the science. You came here and you promised us a solution to this problem, and I think this agreement will allow the city to become a problem to the solution.
Where's this? No, I just need to call out the next name.
Diane Fossefani.
And you want to call like two or three names in a row so that Natalie can put you
down?
Natalie's going to call out a few names in a row so that the people who are next can start
Marlene
to line up.
Marlene is after Diane and Peter Wright.
I want to thank Glenn Kelly for what he said. I completely concur with his statements. That's number one. Number two, I'm asking, because of the short duration of this comment period, that the comment period, instead of commencing from the 14th, commenced from the first time you really reached out to the public, which was today. and go from 30 days from today and possibly, I understand that there's going to be a repair or some work being done on the salt lot itself with putting a cover on it. And in addition, there is the Union Street Bridge, DOT, is planning to do repairs on that, which may impact movements of contaminants. Is it possible that we could have an additional 15 days? This is becoming very complex, this whole thing. So 30 days from today and an additional 15 so that we can look at what those DOT impacts may be and you know, talk about how this is going to end up making this the boondoggle that Glenn referred to. Okay, thank you very much, and I'm glad you're not retired.
Thank you, Diane. So under the Superman rules, if we get a request for an extension, we must give one of 15 days, and that is what we're doing. So I am now unilaterally advising you that the public comment period is extended by 15 days. So if the arithmetic is correct, it's from May 16th till May 31st. So I am rejecting the proposal that the comment period start today. We gave full notice on the 14th, and ordinarily a public meeting such as this one occurs in the middle of a comment period. We want people to have a chance to get acquainted before the meeting with the circumstances, then we come to a meeting like this, and then we give them some time after the meeting to write their comments and submit them. So I'm satisfied that the level of notice we provided on April 14th of the start of the comment period was sufficient. We are now extending the comment period until May 31st. Next speaker.
Marlene Van Peter.
Okay, so I have some concerns basically about the cost and how you're saying we're trading off certain things that we're getting as a result of this, things that, but we also have to look really very much at the cost. A lot of us have seen a recent tweet issued by our councilman, Brad Lander, saying that there is a $510 million have been allocated for this. That's practically the cost of the whole cleanup that was posted before. That's an excessive amount of money that's going towards this, and we're looking at what it is we're spending that extra amount of money for is to mitigate the potential loss of space of use of the park for a time period of time and the potential long-term use of the park by possible displacement of space for building space. And we get this agreement. We all have to stop and say, is this worth this? Are we really getting much for this incredible extra cost that's going in here? And I'm not so sure that we are. I think we have to look at that very carefully. I'm also really concerned that the claim that why we're doing this is about the loss of parkland and the possible suit that you might be parkland, when we had a presentation before the CAG by the landowners that are being threatened by eminent domain in this process to give back parkland, and that's not considered anywhere in this presentation or the proposal. That's still a much more cost-effective process, and it's not part of this process here. It's not part of this recommendation, and it concerns me. I'm also very concerned that the first thing I see on the timeline in the whole decision is a EULR process. I'm very suspicious of why this is very expensive and why it's taking very long, and we do know that our councilman wants to move forth land use changes comprehensively across the area. We know that he's stated he's against spot rezoning, so he might not stop at those two. There's a lot of money here, there's a lot of time, and I don't think we should be having land use procedures under the Superfund process. At our recent land use committee meeting, I had everybody in the room agree that ULURP or land use and zoning procedures should not be part of a Superfund. I said it three times, didn't I, Marianne? And yes. Everybody agreed. We should not have land use processes as a part of this. It's possible under the EPA laws to not have that, so we do not want to open it up. If it is sincerely about not taking parkland away, then why are we doing the land use process? If the park and DEP are really about not of having an agreement, they will relinquish that. Because if it's about land use, that's what they're arguing for, they're going to hold on to it. I think we should get land use out of the agreement 100%.
Yeah, I'm going to just mention one thing, or two, excuse me. First is that we are cognizant of discussions between the city And Alloy, the company that has the 99-year-long lease on, I think, one of the parcels, or is it both parcels? Both parcels? Both parcels. To my knowledge, no agreement has been reached at this stage of the game between the city and Alloy or the landowners, so we can't take account of that one way or the other. We did take account of the fact that if the tank is built at the head of canal location, the city is committed to creating more open space. That is because they're not going to allow development buildings on top of the tank. So wherever the tank is, that space will be open. Let me also mention on the ULURP process, so we do have a schedule in this proposed administrative order for initiating and completing the ULURP and SEQR, C-E-Q-R, processes. And failure to comply with that schedule would be one of the elements that could enable EPA to require the pivot to the other location. The city takes the position, legally, that it cannot acquire property in this manner without going through the ULURP or SEQR processes. The city takes the position that the same would be true if it placed the tank in the park location. As I said, that was one of the disagreements that EPA and the city had.
Hey, Peter Reich, R-E-I-C-H. Okay. I'm new to all this, so bear with me. I just had a couple of design questions. The green part of the park, the area closest to 3rd Avenue, that's unaffected by all of this? I'm unclear. Okay.
So the question is, the green part of the park, which is to the east of the area that has to be excavated for coal tar purposes, and where the tank would have been located if that were the location. The green part of the park is unaffected in the sense that, number one, there's not coal tar under it, so it doesn't have to be dug up for that purpose, and number two, the tank wouldn't go there. As to whether or not the park, the so-called green portion of the park, could remain open while the work goes on, either for coal tar removal and or for tank construction, that's an open question. It might be too disruptive, it might be too dangerous, but it otherwise wouldn't be affected by the construction. And we think it could probably remain open at least in some fashion.
Kids love construction. I realize this is petty given the scope of this project, but the trees along the sidewalk of the pool and the handball courts, are they getting torn up too, or is it just within the park?
The question was whether the trees along the sidewalk of the boundary of the park where it fronts on the streets, whether those trees will have to be removed as part of the overall work that's going on there. I think
so it's within the fence perimeter.
Exactly.
Okay. And then the third thing, if the city gets its wish and the holding tanks go right at the head of the canal, whether it makes any sense to do the tanks and then permanently relocate the pool on top of them there rather than do a temporary location and then move it back again, so it's disruption after disruption. Just putting it out there. I assume someone thought about it.
Thank you.
In response to that last question, it's a timing question. We would expect that the excavation of the park site, which is going to be required regardless of where the tank goes, will take place on roughly the same schedule, in roughly the same time frame, as the excavation on the head of canal location, assuming the tank goes there. Next speaker.
We have Izzy, then Triada. You're next.
My name is Izzy Dowdy. I've lived in this district all my life, and I'm outraged by this agreement. Let me explain something to all of you about compliant sewage overflows. The crap from the rich people in Park Slope that they flush down their toilets winds up in the Gowanus Canal currently. And yes, you're trying very nicely to fix this by putting some retention tanks in there. who lives around this canal now but the people who live in the Wyckoff Towers and the other housing projects around this neighborhood? This is some of the most diverse socioeconomically and racially census tracts in our entire district. These people who we haven't cared that have been living by this horribly polluted canal, I think we can all agree on that, the canal is polluted and it should be fixed. They've been living there for a long, long time. And what do they have? They don't have a clean air and clean water. They don't have. They can't go outside in the night after it rains and not smell a putrid scent. But they do have this beautiful pool and this beautiful park and this beautiful space, which they have made theirs and which is the key to their community. You can't just replace it with another park, because that park is their park, and that park represents them, and that park represents the one concession that we've given them after we've systematically disenfranchised them in about every other way possible. So, we're spending $500 million on this. I agree with you, that's far too much money. And what are we getting out of it? We, I don't think, are getting anything, but the developers who build along this canal houses for more rich people to live in, they're getting something out of it. Is that enough? Is that enough to rebuild the park? I don't know. Under an environmental guise, sure, I think it's great to renovate the park. But putting a tank full of crap underneath the pool, even if it would never possibly leak into the pool, is such an unfathomable insult to those who are on the bottom of our class system, and I think it's unconscionable. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaker.
After Priyana, it will be Katia, and then Linda.
Hi. Oh, my name is Triada Samaris. I'm a longtime resident here. I want to ad-lib something. I'm going to read something also, but I'm sorry. Is this okay? The reasoning that you gave for the timeline, you said there could be some inconsistencies in the original timeline, and you used that as a reason why the new timeline could be seen as reasonable. I didn't think that that was logical at all, because you mentioned there could be some maybe legal contingencies or something could happen with the original plan that would stretch original timeline out. I think if that's true, then it's also true of this new timeline, which maybe is 2020, but maybe would be 2024 under that reasoning, especially because this timeline now with the bullet points involves so many parties. I can see lawyers' litigiousness becoming a real drag on the ability of the work to progress. So that's a real, I think that's a real reason I favor and have always favored the original plan and the original siting. Another thing I'd like to say is that I have always wondered what the role of Mr. Stringer, the Comptroller Stringer's office, will be in approving eminent domain, the purchase price. We heard the figure $125 million. Last meeting, I don't know if that was for one piece of property or more than one, but it's an extremely high price. And I think that most people in here would agree that $125 million spent by taxpayers could be spent so much better in this neighborhood, acquiring parkland, little corners, making this a more habitable place. We still are living in a Superfund designated area, and we are the most dense population around this Superfund designated area. So I think spending $125 million to seize someone's private property is not wise and is outrageously expensive. And I would favor anything but that. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think there were two ways in which the comptroller's office could conceivably have been involved. Maybe there's others. When we were negotiating the proposed agreement with the city of New York, they initially were under the impression that once the city administration, the Department of Environmental Protection, decided that they were prepared to go ahead with the agreement, they would need to pass it through the comptroller's office first for a check to see that it was done in a procedurally appropriate way. Based upon advice from the law department, they've concluded that that is not necessary. I don't have any answers as to whether or not the comptroller's, or in what way the comptroller's office might be involved in the decision to expend funds for the eminent domain. I think probably through the ULURP process, there's some opportunity for all stakeholders to be heard. But again, that's a detail that I'm not familiar with, and it's up to the city to work that that process out directly.
What if the controller's office was against spending the money?
So as I said, there are contingencies in this administrative order. If the city is not able to go through the steps that are required to exercise eminent domain in the time schedules that are provided, then EPA can require the city to revert back to the park location for which the design will be done, because we're having both designs carried out simultaneously. I might add that, is my understanding from what the city officials explained to us, is that there are two possible points at which litigation can take place in an eminent domain proceeding. One is that in order to carry out eminent domain, a municipality like the City of New York has to go through an administrative process to say, this is what we plan to do. And that process, in their judgment, requires the ULURP and SEAKER procedures, among others. If there's an allegation by the property owner that they've failed to do that or failed to do it properly, litigation can be brought before the eminent domain takes place. Assuming that the city can get through that process, and if they fail to, that's a scheduled event, and failure to meet a scheduled deadline allows us to require the pivot. The second opportunity for litigation is after the city exercises eminent domain. At that moment that the exercise of eminent domain occurs, the city owns the property, period. And the city has to put up a certain amount of money, 90%, I think, of what they estimate the cost to be. If the landowner at that point disputes the assessed value or the estimated value that the city has put on it, there can be another litigation about the value. But that doesn't stop the change of title. The title will have moved from the landowner to the city at the moment the city exercises eminent domain. And they can argue for a long time thereafter about the actual amount of money. That doesn't slow down the process in any way. It's the litigation before the exercise of eminent domain that was a matter of concern to us, and that's why the schedule allows us to cause the pivot if that litigation takes longer than the 4-year period that we have discussed.
Excuse me. Are you saying the second case of, in the second case, you're not worried about the time being interrupted?
That is correct. That is, once any municipality exercises eminent domain, and in the case of the City of New York, that requires this administrative process to be carried out beforehand. But once that occurs, and the municipality says, we're taking your property, at that moment, title passes from the owner to the municipality, and the only remaining question to be litigated is how much money the municipality owes to the property owner. If the property owner is unsatisfied with the amount of money that the municipality has identified, then the property owner can go to court and say, hey, this wasn't enough money, it's really worth much more. And they can litigate about that, but the title has passed. At that point, the municipality owns the property.
I'm sorry, I'm taking a little longer than I thought I would. But so, will that be taxpayer money? If money is argued about and more money needs to be paid, again, it's coming from taxpayers. Just so everyone understands. And the other thing is, that sort of proves, I'm not trying to be a know-it-all, but it proves my point about many inconsistencies in the new plan, where I can't imagine 4 years going only 4 years. It seems like there's plenty of spaces for that to stretch out. Just as you said, in the original, there could be some problems. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And as I said, that schedule, that 4-year schedule from now till April 2020, that's a schedule that is subject to milestone events along the way, which, if they are not fulfilled, allows EPA to require the city to move the location over to the park. Katja.
Hi, EPA crew. We've been together now in this community with Katja Kelly, K-A-T-I-A-K-E-L-L-Y. It has been a long road. You came to the community, as my husband said. We trusted you guys, and we still trust your, or I still trust your engineering. I just don't trust the political aspect. I have two questions, one for you, Walter, and hopefully one for Christos, the engineer, because there's a couple of inconsistencies with the engineering part that I would like to clarify. If you can go to your proposed agreement slide, the very first one. My first comment, I looked through the agreement, and as you said, Walter, it's very, very difficult to understand for somebody who is not a lawyer or, you know, a scientist, but it seems to me that nowhere in the agreement does it actually specify a 4 million gallon tank for OH-007 and an $8 million tank for RH-034. Are you going to go ahead and include that in the agreement? Like I said, I'm just a little housewife, and if I were to sign an agreement, I would make sure that that's in there, because the city has contested that. I like what you said, that there seems to be an agreement on that. I insist, as a member of the community, that those two numbers get put in there. So that's my first comment. The slide about proposed agreement, I'm reading this, and I think it was confirmed, what I understood was confirmed by what you said, Walter, that the agreement is on the design and site preparation. There's something left out there, the actual building of the tank. When? Because it's not in there. The agreement has nothing to do when that tank is going to be built. It basically only asks the city to put a big hole in the ground. So why would EPA go ahead and sign an agreement that still does not give us a tank, which means that we are going to get recontamination, which is something that the EPA told us is a big no-no, and that no polluter would be allowed to recontaminate the canal. So I would like to know when exactly the tank is going to be built, and if you will indulge me, I would like to ask Christos two or three questions also.
So the two questions you had, the first question was that the proposed agreement does not specify the 4 million and 8 million gallon tank size. That is correct. That was the size of the tank is an element of the design. And so the design has to be submitted to us by the city, and we have to then either approve it or disapprove it. And there are steps along the way. There's, I think, a 35% and a 65% design step along the way. If we have told the city that if they submit to us a design, anything other than the 4 million and 8 million gallon tanks, we will disapprove it. The city has accepted those sizes. There will be other documents that will memorialize that decision as part of the design process. In fact, there is in the administrative record for this agreement a memorandum that I put into the file explaining our reasons for making the decisions that are summarized here. I am also expecting to put into the file at some point, probably prior to this agreement being finalized, if it is, a separate memorandum that memorializes my communications and that of my boss, the regional administrator Judith Enck, with Commissioner Emily Lloyd, in which the specific questions of the tank sizing were addressed, and I'll memorialize those decisions that we have made and the communication of those decisions to the city and their acceptance thereof. But the actual formal document that does it will be either an approval of a city design document or a disapproval with required changes to the design document. The second question you asked is, why doesn't this agreement include in it the obligation to construct the tanks? And the answer for that is that under the Superfund law, an administrative consent order cannot be used, is not permitted to be used as the vehicle to memorialize the agreement to carry out what's called a Superfund remedial action. An administrative consent order is allowed for what is called a removal action, and that's why you'll see the word removal in a couple of locations in this presentation and in the order itself. Just for those who aren't spending all their time in Superfund law, Superfund divides cleanup actions into two species. One is called a removal action, the other is called a remedial action. Congress, in its wisdom, gave us different legal obligations or different legal mechanisms that had to be used to memorialize an agreement by a responsible party to carry out a remedial action different from those that we can use for a removal action. For a removal action, we can use an administrative order. Administrative simply means that I, as an official of the Environmental Protection Agency, can issue that order. It's an authority that has been delegated from the president to the administrator of EPA, to the regional administrator of EPA, down to the Superfund division director. Under the Superfund law, a consensual agreement to carry out a remedial action, which is what the construction of the tank would be and what the canal dredging will be, that must be done through what's called a judicial consent order. It's a document that goes and is presented, a judicial consent decree. It's a document that has to get presented to a court, the United States District Court. Again, there's a public comment period on that, and ultimately the court, if it agrees, and normally it does, then enters that as an order of the court. So that's the different ways in which the Superfund law specifies that EPA carry these out. Because the construction of the tank will be a remedial action, it has to be done in a different mechanism. So, what is our intention? Our intention is that, assuming this order goes into place, and assuming that the next order to National Grid, which I alluded to in the comments in the presentation, assuming that one gets put in place within the next several months, the next step after that is for us to start to engage with all of the responsible parties on the negotiation of a judicial consent decree, which we hope will be successful, and that will then require the actual construction work, including detailed time schedules for all of that work. I predict that we will still have differences of opinion as we go into those negotiations for how long it will take to carry out this construction work. We'll have to have those discussions, and eventually it'll be up to us to make a decision on what we think is appropriate. If a consensual agreement cannot be achieved, we still have the authority to issue a unilateral administrative order under the Superfund law. And we've done that in other circumstances where we've been unable to reach a consent about a remedial action, and then we issue a unilateral order, and that becomes a legally binding obligation. Again, it doesn't have some of the benefits of a consensual agreement, but it is a very powerful legal instrument.
So anyway, I have a couple of questions for Kustos. I did reach out to the EPA and ask for some technical support to explain why the EPA made the decision that it did make. And I received a couple of documents that were correspondences between EPA and DEP regarding technical aspects of the tank. And I just wanted to clarify. I mean, Kustos, you go on record as saying that that the design for the 8 million gallon tank, the hole in the wall and the headhouse by DEP, both of them are excessively designed. So obviously, you know, they're over-engineering this, which I guess is their right, but our taxpayers' money. There was one thing that struck me in particular, and that was the fact that EPA in the correspondence talks about a setback of greater than 20 feet on the order of 45 or 50 feet to provide an improved margin of safety in the construction of the tank and allow for the installation of tiebacks for National Grid's cutoff wall. So something about the fact that the tank cannot be too close to the bulkheads on the private site. And there's discussion about 20 feet, 45 feet, 50 feet. What is it? How far do they have to remove it and move it back? And what's, you know, it seems very complex engineering-wise, and I was just wondering.
I'm going to answer these questions. I appreciate that you posed them to Kustos, but I'm going to answer them.
Yeah.
I'm the Superfund Division Director. I'm ultimately responsible for this. So here are the answers to your questions. On March 16th, we had a technical meeting with the City of New York. Prior to that time, Kustos provided technical comments to the City of New York, which we discussed at that March 16th meeting. They included issues that might be characterized as, in our judgment, excessive or over-design. We have not yet gotten the final responses from the city, but we'll be looking very carefully at those. Ultimately, it is a. There are decisions that the city can choose to make on its own, which we may consider to be unnecessary, but as long as they don't unreasonably prolong the schedule or make it otherwise impossible to build, that is the city's choice. As to the setback question, we've had further conversations with National Grid and with the City of New York. The 40 or 45 feet that we talked about actually is now going to be 100 feet. So the city is setting back 100 feet. The National Grid said they needed 80 feet. The city has made a choice to set back 100 feet. That was communicated to me last Thursday night from the bulkhead to allow for the tiebacks to be as long as they need to be and for there to be a buffer space in between the tiebacks and the city's activities. Now, the details will still be in design documents that need to be submitted pursuant to the schedule that's in this proposed agreement. But those are the communications that we have had as recently as last Thursday night with the city. All right, thank you. And Natalie reminds me that we need to move a little more quickly because there are 19 people still to be speaking, so I'm probably as much as at fault. I'll try and limit my remarks, but I'll ask you to do the same.
Hi, Lynn Mariano. Is it too late to pave over the canal? Linda Mariano, M-A-R-I-A-N-O. I had to do that.
Say it again.
Is it too late to pave over the canal? I have the feeling, is it a kooky idea to even suggest that the smaller tank be placed on the site at the head of the canal and rather than at the salt lot area? That's one question.
I'll answer it quickly. Okay. So the sizes of the two different tanks have to do with how much discharge there is in those two different locations. The two different discharge locations drain different portions of the surrounding territory, so they simply have different amounts of CSO going out. That's why one has to be double the size of the other. So you can't switch the locations.
Okay. One other question about the hydrology of the area. How will the pumping station and the mechanism that operates the pumping flushing station be affected by the two tanks so close to the canal?
So there is a pump station that is located at this spot because at the head of canal there's a low point in the piping system that is otherwise moving by gravity. It has to be pumped back up again in order to eventually reach the Red Hook sewage treatment plant for treatment. That pumping station will not be affected one way or the other by the placement of the retention tank here. The idea of the retention tank is that when the pipe is full, the next 8 million gallons of sewage and rainwater will go into the tank. Now, if the rain continues, there will then be some amount of discharge into the canal, but it'll be much cleaner because most of the sewage that's in that what's called the first flush will have been captured in the tank. Once Christos has made the calculations in designing preparing the remedial decision of how many times in an average year or an expected year will this tank be full and some additional discharge go into the water. It's a small number of occasions, and it's a small amount, comparatively speaking, on those occasions. In all other circumstances, when the 8 million gallon tank is full, or however much collects in there is collected, once the rain stops, then it is pumped out of the tank by a different set of pumps from the existing pump station. It's pumped back out of the tank, back into the pipes that normally carry the sewage. It'll then move to the existing pump station, which will lift it up, and it'll end up at the Red Hook sewage treatment plant.
Friendly acquisition is rather inappropriate here in the 21st century, and I think we should recognize that we would, with the use of eminent domain, approximately 350 to 400 jobs would be lost by displacing the property owners on those sites that the city wants to take by friendly acquisition. And there are other properties on Nevin Street that are available, that are for sale, and why aren't those properties not selected rather than a property that doesn't want to be sold or taken?
Who's next?
Mary Ann Young. Before I start, I diddle whatever Glenn Kelly says, okay? And I need to ask this question for our group, is why if parkland alienation was such a determining factor in allowing city to build tanks on private land, is there no mention of Alloy's proposed land donation to offset loss of park space in the agreement? Did EPA even consider this offer?
So as I said earlier, there is no existing agreement between the city and Alloy. Therefore, we have nothing that we can take account of right now. We're certainly aware of the communications between Alloy and the city. Indeed, I met with Alloy and the property owners myself maybe 2 months ago. So we're aware of those negotiations and discussions, but they, to our knowledge, have not resulted in an agreement. Therefore, there is nothing that we can take official account of.
So you're just saying that if the city doesn't work with Alloy, then you can't offer any kind of solution. So you're just saying that if there's no real agreement or negotiation going on between city and Alloy, then therefore EPA has nothing to do with it, right?
For the purposes of this conversation, that is correct.
Okay. And then I also want to know that there is that special clause where they're not going to be challenging you at a certain point. This is the city saying that. Now, what about the state or National Grid or other PRP coming up and challenging on that? Is there any kind of agreement that protects you from that?
So the question is whether this waiver of a right to challenge the CSO element of the remedy affects other parties like National Grid or the state. So first of all, the state concurred in our remedy, so the state agrees with the remedy that we selected in 2013. They're fully supportive of that. That was a written concurrence. And they would not have any legal ability to challenge it in court, even if they disagreed, but they don't. As to National Grid or one of the 30 or so other responsible parties, they have no direct interest, in our judgment, in the CSO element of this remedy, and we would not be enforcing against them the CSO element of this remedy. That's an obligation on the city of New York. However, that being said, when we enter into our negotiations with National Grid, which we now will do, we will be asking National Grid to make a comparable waiver of its right to challenge the elements of the remedy that affect it.
Okay. Another thing. There's a lot of city agencies with different priorities, different rules, regulations, and so forth. There's that tank that's 7007 that's happening in the salt lot. Right now, currently, there is structures being built right there for the salt lot as well as the disposal. How is that handling if the retention tank has to go in?
So the question is about other city activities on 007. I will discuss this tomorrow night with the CAG. It is not relevant to tonight's program because it's not part of this proposed agreement, but if we do have responses to that, that we'll be sharing with you. All right? Thanks. Next speaker.
My name is Sean Dixon. I'm here speaking on behalf of Riverkeeper. First, I wanted to thank you for answering all of our questions as opposed to those meetings where you just sit there and say thank you and then move on. So that was really, really great of you guys. And I'm sure we're going to be doing the same thing tomorrow. But I had a couple quick questions about the tanks themselves. You know, Riverkeeper's been on the record in favor of the expedited cleanup. And as you just mentioned, the whole idea of the construction of the tanks is next. So the way we read this order today, 4 years, 2020, that's when the, you know, acquisition has to happen. Then there's some sort of mysterious coordinate with National Grid on the first part of the cleanup. Then there's a 2 years of finishing the hole. So we're thinking about 2023 for the hole in the ground to be completed. What's your estimate on that? Maybe 2023, hopefully 2021, two. Anyway, the question based on that, wherever that lands, I know you said that you haven't yet begun negotiating the CSO tanks, but my first question of hopefully a short two questions would be, what is your estimate and what is the EPA's position on what it's going to be asking for how long the CSO tanks will be built over and when we'll actually have them operating in the canal?
It's a complicated set of questions, which I'm certainly prepared to speak to the CAG in more detail tomorrow night. Let me just say briefly here that by April 2020, the eminent domain has to take place. They have to have acquired the property by April 2020. At that point, the first step is that National Grid will, by that time, have had to have designed and planned its cleanup of that property, and it will have to then start that very soon after the acquisition occurs. And then, after Grid completes its work, which might take maybe a year, then the city has to be ready to move ahead with its preparation of the hole, which includes removal of contaminated soil, and the subsequent, immediately by that time, then going into the actual construction of the tank. And that whole process might take perhaps 3 years, perhaps four, perhaps five. That's an argument that we're still going to have with the city. All right?
My next shorter questions are, you mentioned two of the things that you advocated for in the negotiations were open space and cleaning up any contaminants that may enter the canal after the remedy is begun, but before the tanks are in place. Both of those seem to have giant caveats and asterisks on them. So I didn't read in the order that there's a requirement that there be open space on top of the head of canal location, were that to be the final choice. And I didn't read that there was a requirement that the city clean up any contaminated sediments, only if found necessary by the EPA. Question is on that cleaning up of the sediments, is that something that's open to, or that's covered in the waiver of a right to litigation, or is that something that you can still disagree on in the future? And did you consider requiring, and can we convince you to require, open space and cleanup, full stop?
I'll take that as a comment, as well as a question. So. We thought about it. We believe that that is something that's appropriate in a remedial consent decree. And so that's probably where that will be dealt with, as will be the schedule of the construction.
Okay. And then one final note. If you're, as you're building the record, I don't expect you to have this number in front of you. You said in your letter, you said in your opening statement that the park location would be quicker, cheaper, and easier, I believe. Do you have numbers on how much quicker, how much cheaper, and specifics on how easier it would be that you can put on the record or with you today?
So the numbers we made in the rod, we made estimates of the costs. The city argued in its comments on the proposed plan that those costs were too low, and that seems to still be the city's position. In terms of the timing, we have made projections as to how long things will take, but the actual schedule will be subject to the remedial negotiations.
Thanks for that answer.
Okay. And we'll see you tomorrow night at the CAG meeting. Yeah, and my colleague Tom reminds me that the April 2020 is a deadline. There are possibilities for having that date be earlier, and that could include a consensual acquisition of property, or it could include getting to the point of being able to exercise eminent domain more quickly than the four-year schedule.
Mark, M-A-R-K, Shames, S-H-A-M-E-S. It's a pleasure to be at this pre-CAG meeting. What Sean was talking about is essentially what I wanted to talk about, so I'm not going to repeat any of that. What I did want to note is that the first milestone is April 1st, 2016, for the beginning of the EIS. Have we met that first milestone, or have we already missed the first milestone?
The order has not yet gone into effect, and therefore the city's obligation to give us monthly status reports hasn't yet started. Nevertheless, it's my understanding that those actions have started. am I, is Eric Landau here? Yes, from the DEP. Kevin, the answer is yes.
Hi, Michelle Delados from the Fifth Avenue Committee. First, I just want to thank EPA and its staff for a tremendous amount of work, honestly, and I think taking a pretty complex situation and agreement and trying to break it down for us. I really appreciate that. I have three questions. Just talking a little bit more about the administrative order with National Grid, if you could talk a little bit more about its timing, the status that you're at in negotiations with National Grid, and some of the high points, I think that would be helpful. I don't know if you want me to give you all three at once or okay, sure. The next one has to do with the community involvement for input into the design of the temporary and permanent parks. Like, where would that be handled? You know, is it in the National Grid administrative order? Is it in the next remedial agreement? I think it would be really helpful. That's a primary concern that a lot of folks have, and I think it would be helpful to know where that would get reflected. And then finally, it's obviously come up a couple different times about the importance of the conversation that DEP is having with Alloy, and I know that you may not have the details on that, but I think especially during this public review or public comment period, it would be helpful to hear directly from DEP about the status of those conversations, because I think it may give some folks either more cause for hope or more cause for concern, depending on how that's trending. Because I think, you know, obviously if we have a situation where eminent domain can be avoided and we can extend open space, and, you know, the worst case scenario that EPA has tried to, you know, mitigate against doesn't happen, that could be a tremendous win-win. So it'd be helpful to hear from DEP. Thank you.
Thanks. Your first question was timing of the planned administrative order with National Grid. As soon as this process is completed, that's next on our to-do list. I would assume that that process might take 4 or 5 months, give or take. Second question was, what about community involvement regarding the design of the temporary and permanent parks, pools? That would be a subject for inclusion in the National Grid Administrative Order. The need to do some of that, we'll have to figure out how to coordinate between the city, because ultimately it's the city's Parks Department that's obliged to ensure that these designs are satisfactory, and probably to oversee the handling, the management of those park facilities and things of that sort. So we'll have to work that through in our discussions with Grid and interacting with the city. And as to the Alloy discussions, it'll be up to the city if they want to, in some forum, share what they're doing with Alloy. I will say the following, that because we have settled on about a 100-foot setback, there may not be a great deal of opportunity for a joint utilization of the property. Alloy, if they were going to use part of the property, would have to have it face Nevins Street rather than be behind the tank on the canal. At least that strikes me as being more plausible. I shouldn't make a final decision on that. But the city and Alloy are discussing where the tank would be on the property and what that would leave, if anything, for Alloy to use for development purposes. Again, I'm not a party to those discussions. EPA has no role in those discussions, other than to say, here's what you need to do on the setback. Let me go on. Again, I'll be there at the CAG tomorrow night. If you're going to be there, I can continue to talk about that. Who's next?
Walter, I'm happy to speak to that if you want to.
Eric Landau from the New York City DEP can maybe step forward and say a few words. Again, I know we're running out of time here, so.
Thank you, Walter, and thank you for this evening. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Eric Landau. I'm Deputy Commissioner at New York City Department of Environmental Protection. Just very, very quickly, Michelle, to your question, and Brad Cook from Alloy is with us tonight as well. Since the December CAG meeting when Alloy made its very thoughtful presentation, the City of New York, both the Parks Department and the Department of Environmental Protection, have been in regular conversations with Alloy about those properties, and about looking at ways that we can both be on the canal properties and achieve our shared goals. Obviously, the setback that Walter talks about is part of that conversation now. That's not the only option we're looking at. We're looking at lots of others. But the bottom line message is this, that yes, eminent domain is part of this conversation, certainly. We've been talking about it a lot tonight, but it is not where we are right now. It's a tool, but it's one that we hope we never have to use. It's really a last resort, and one that we hope that we never have to use, and are very hopeful and confident that the productive conversations that Alloy and the city have been having continue, and that we reach an agreement to meet our shared goals. Thank you, Walter.
Thank you, Eric. Next speaker.
Hello, Walter. Hello, everyone. Thank you. My name is Joseph Alexiou, A-L-E-X-I-O-U. My few questions, not to repeat everyone else's questions, specifically, the first one had to do with if the tank location is going to take place in the private land. There was mention of there actually being more open land created there on one of the slides. Can we see that slide, or what was that specifically, or if you could just sort of like explain that?
So it's long been understood. It isn't specifically written anywhere in a binding way, but it's long been understood that the city doesn't want any commercial or residential development on top of a tank, or industrial for that matter, doesn't want any kind of development on top of a tank, and the flip side of that is the developers don't want to build residential or commercial property on top of a tank. So wherever the tank gets built, setting aside the question of the head house, wherever the tank gets built, any portion above the tank that doesn't have the head house on it will almost by definition become open space.
So you just answered my question, which is how can you talk about the head house as taking away open parkland and space, and then at the same time say that that land will be open space? Those two things seem quite not, like they don't go together very well.
Yeah, let me, I probably was a little obscure about that. If the tank were to be placed underneath the park, then the logical place for the, not the only place, but a logical place for the head house would be above the tank, and it would occupy some space within the current footprint of the park. If the tank is created at the head of canal location, which currently is not part of the park, then the majority of the footprint of the tank will have above it nothing, it'll be open space, but some fraction of that footprint will have the head house on top of it. That would create a net increase in open space, because it would be in addition to the current footprint of the Thomas Green Park.
Right. Okay, I have to say that while I understand your answer, I find the math there to be a little bit, this is the problem that I have in general with this entire process, is that as long as we argue about it, you know, we can continue to come up with these explanations for why one thing is another. Just like we have this idea that we're spending more, you know, someone said, several people said, we're spending more people's tax money to do a greater, it's not to buy this land and make use of it. It's not tax money, it's the raising of the water rates, is that correct? The raising of the water rates comes from business owners and real estate owners who are there. Those water rates were earmarked before this decision was ever even made. If I'm correct about that, and that the city had planned this before the decision was ever made. So we've already, before the signatures were made, this has already been factored into the city's budget for next year, isn't it? Isn't that the case?
No, so a couple of answers. So water rates are paid by everybody who uses water. It is, Joseph is correct, that it is the water rates that pay for this, for both sewage management and clean drinking water. The city has a 10-year capital plan that the water board is subject to. Every 2 years it gets updated, is my understanding. And so at a time when a commitment is legally made to carry out a certain capital project, at that point the 10-year plan certainly has to include the cost estimate for that activity. I don't know exactly at what point in the budgetary cycle the costs for this tank were put into the capital project. All right, I think it was last month. I think you're right about that. Okay, so but that's the budgetary process that goes on here, yes. Okay. And by March, the city was pretty well along the way on the negotiations, which is why they then put it in.
Okay, so thank you for clarifying that. And so, again, I just want to point out something that we were talked about before, is that the entire cost the city estimates for this tank is approximately $506 to $510 million, and that includes acquisition and everything else. And $506 to $510 million was the EPA's projected cost for the entire cleanup project, including two tanks and the removal of all this stuff. So there's a huge discrepancy between what the EPA says and what the city says the cost should be and the plan should be. And finally, you have also sort of pointed out now, and I just want to make sure I get this language right, that effectively the city sort of has the power to challenge in court the decision of the EPA, which is something you wanted to avoid in order to get to where we are now, which is, to me, the subtext here is that the city did threaten to go to court if we didn't negotiate with them. And that's sort of what I'm seeing playing out here. And I, whether or not I'm right, and I may be totally wrong about that, I think that's where all the people that are angry are most angry about. And I want to go on the record and say that these discrepancies, including what we just talked about, the head house taking away, you know, green space, but suddenly giving it green space if it's private land, these things are all very troubling to me. And I don't think that necessarily we're all, you know, the city's wrong and the, you know, the EPA's right. I just think that it could be even more clear and open, a conversation with actual numbers and facts, like the 10 years that it's gonna take for us to get to the point of tank construction before we actually begin. All of those things should be said more clearly. Just we would ask for that in general. And I think that's what the EPA did up until a certain point. And that is, again, where things get complicated and upsetting. And thank you so much for your time.
Thanks. So just to answer your question directly, the city did not threaten litigation, but litigation is always a possibility when we move to enforce any instrument at all. So that's one of the things that we are concerned about. Who's the next speaker?
Thank you. Assemblywoman Joanne Simon. Hi, how are you? So I just wanted to say that I'm very pleased that this meeting is being held and that it's being held in this format, that people are able to ask the questions that they have to ask, and that Mr. Mugden has been so gracious in answering these questions as well as he had. I know that many of you are concerned about this agreement, just as many of you have been concerned that the advocacy around keeping park space has perhaps been viewed as a less than hearty support for cleaning up the canal. I can assure you that that's not the case. I have been concerned about the loss of this park space since before I was elected. Worked on this park and keeping this park a park, and having more and more people enjoy this park, which is critical and central to so many communities. And I think it is very important that we maintain as much public park space as we can. I think the net open space is a real positive here. And while we can debate the costs, of which we don't really know what those are going to be in any event, the timetables that are set out in this agreement are very important protection for everyone here, both those who want to retain as much park space and the use of the pool as possible, as well as those of you who are concerned about the passage of time and the cleanup of the canal area. I also want to say that while, and I certainly hope that there is an agreement to be reached and there we don't have to get to the point of eminent domain, there is a reason eminent domain exists, and that's for public use. And I can't think of anything that's more of a public use than cleaning up our environment and providing open space for our children to play. So I want to thank everybody for being here, and I've been listening to everybody's comments this evening, and I'll stay to the end of the meeting, and I look forward to continuing the dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you, Assemblywoman. Who's the next speaker? Here we go.
Hello. My name is Philip Warren. I manage Eastern Effects Studios, which is the facility directly south of the Hedda Canal location. My question is, will any of the properties or businesses outside of the yellow square be affected by either of the tank site construction zones?
Fair question. Again, I'm just going to show the piece of property that you were alluding to is this one right here, am I correct?
Yes, we also have an office within Head of Canal.
But right here, right?
Yeah.
Or this building.
I'm mainly concerned about the first one.
So, in addition, for any construction project of this magnitude, a staging area is necessary, highly desirable. That's where equipment and materials can be staged that are then necessary for the construction project itself. Regardless of which site is located, is selected for the tank, The city has identified, and we have agreed, that this is a logical location for the staging area. That means that this area would have to be acquired as well. It could be through a voluntary purchase agreement, or it could be through eminent domain. In addition, there is underneath this property, we believe, a considerable amount of coal tar. So when and if that property is acquired, that would be an opportunity, and the buildings would be then removed. At that point, there would be an opportunity and an obligation for National Grid to come in and remove the coal tar that's underneath it, even before the site is used as a staging area. So whether this tank goes here or whether it goes there, a staging area needs to be selected. That's the current target that the city has identified. We have no objection to it. It makes sense. If the head of canal location is where the tank gets built, then the city has told us what they would probably do is close off this last block of DeGraw Street between Nevins and the canal. That would give them a free and clear access between the staging area and the construction site. But again, those are all parts of the design that have yet to come.
Hi, I actually work with Randy. No, I didn't. So, but we need to ask a question with regards to how this piece of property is. My name is Ian, I-A-N, Defibaugh, D-E-F-I-B-A-U-G-H. In the event that the property just south of the location is acquired for staging, which you said it has to be, in the event of eminent domain, what sort of rights do we have as a long-term lease, leaser, because at this, we've made a significant investment in this facility, over $1 million, and we actually provide a significant, stimulus to the local environment. The Americans, I'm not sure if you're aware, but the FX show, The Americans, actually is filmed out of this location. It's been there for the last several years. Last 4 years, and it's been estimated that we provide almost a $4 million stimulus to the local economy through these individuals, about 100 people a day, who are using local businesses, going to Lowe's, some of the new restaurants that have opened up in the area. One of the reasons that they're receiving so much business is because of our studio, and we've actually been in the Brooklyn area for almost 16 years. We actually have, we lease like 4 different properties. With this plan, we will be losing 2 of our properties. The DeGraw Street production offices will be acquired for the tank building, but then also our extremely expensive investment that we currently have a 12-year lease on, and we would have a significant loss if this was acquired through eminent domain. What is the city or the responsibility of the city or the EPA with regards to any sort of, compensation to, local businesses for this?
Thanks. So a landowner or a tenant has rights to compensation. That is all part of the eminent domain process if eminent domain is what's utilized. And obviously the investment in a piece of property dictates or affects very directly what the value of that property is. And we certainly are aware of the economic benefit from the existence of the studio there. We're familiar with the number of jobs that are involved. I believe the city is familiar with that as well.
I'm not going to do the mic, because I'll have a panic attack. So I'm Cynthia Simmons, S-I-M-M-O-N-S. And I just want to dovetail very quickly on what Marlene had said about putting in your alert. And I think that I've heard a fear expressed, and we need some type of assurances that your LERP is just going to be specific to this site and it can't be expanded to include like a rezoning or something.
So the question is whether the ULERP process that would be required for part of this eminent domain would just be eminent domain or acquisition. It could even be the ULERP is necessary even for the voluntary acquisition per the city's view of the matter. The question is whether that process can be involved, be also used to do general rezoning. The city can do what it wants, but it needs to adhere to the schedule in this document for completing the ULERP process. And if it goes through, if it tries to use this as a general area-wide rezoning, it's not going to happen. They will not meet this deadline. So I predict that they will not do that.
Next. Thank you.
My name is Michael Higgins, H-I-G-G-I-N-S, Jr., organizer at FURY, Families United for Racial and Economic Equality. We have members in the Gowanus houses. We've been doing the work around the Superfund since the storm happened. We were on the ground, one of the first responders to give residents food, water, medicine, whatever you need, whatever they needed, we tried to make that happen. I have to make sure that we continue to put the equity issue in front. Gowanus houses, in addition to Wyckoff Gardens and Warren Street houses, have about 4,500 residents in the vicinity of the canal. And we're talking about the poorest residents of this community who often have severe asthma issues, severe respiratory issues, severe health issues by living in the vicinity of the canal. And while I don't doubt that this will be a very expensive undertaking, I think that this is the right decision and that we shouldn't necessarily take their little bit of parkland that they have that's accessible and within walking distance of their homes to make this happen quicker. So with that said, I'll say my questions real quickly. I just want to be very clear, who would be responsible for the construction and maintenance of the temporary and permanent facilities at Thomas Green Park while the cleanup is happening? Well, just first
one. Can I ask a question to you?
Yes.
You have other questions?
Okay, yes, sorry. I would also like to ask, and I say this now that I see that the assemblywoman is in the building. Is there still any legal requirement for the state legislature to pass a resolution regarding the alienation of parkland? And one last one, sorry. And last but not least, what is the estimated length of disruption for remediation and reconstruction efforts within the park? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. So the question of who is responsible for building and then maintaining the temporary and the permanent park. As I indicated, National Grid is going to be responsible for building the temporary park. The city will be responsible for operating it, as it would of any other park. And likewise, the permanent park, once it's once the disruption is over and the park is restored, Grid and probably the city will share some of those costs. That'll depend upon negotiations between them. The city ultimately will be responsible for operating it just as it does today. In terms of the legal requirements regarding alienation, I think... I'm sorry, can you just... What, your second question about alienation, can you just repeat it real quickly? Oh, yeah. So whether the state legislature has to get involved in alienation. That was actually a dispute or a difference of opinion, I should say, between ourselves and the city of New York. The city of New York said yes. The normal requirement for state legislative approval of any alienation of parkland would apply. We took the position, and we take the position, that because if the tank were placed in the park, it would be in furtherance of a federal Superfund mandate, that therefore there would be no need to go to the state legislature. That was a point of difference of opinion, of legal opinion between ourselves and the city, and the prospect for litigation is there. That was one of the things I alluded to earlier. So that's an open question, but it was part of what we thought of in our calculus. The question about how long the park disruption will take, that is going to be a subject for these further negotiations. First, an administrative order with National Grid to remove the coal tar contamination from underneath the park. Again, in the sequence of events, the first thing they have to do is site the temporary park and pool. The second thing they have to do is remove the current pool, remove the coal tar contaminated soil from below. And then, in coordination with the city, there'd have to be a restoration of the existing park. Now, Grid's obligation would be to pay the amount of money that would be appropriate to restore the existing pool facilities. It may very well be that in consultation with the community, the city decides at that point, since the pool has been dismantled in any event, it may be time to build a better pool. Yes, this pool is used heavily. We're told it's 40,000 users last year, but I've looked at it, and it's not the best pool facility in the city of New York. So this may be an opportunity to build a better pool, and that will be something that I assume the city would be working together with the community on. Is that correct, Commissioner? Commissioner Jeffries is here as the Borough Commissioner for Parks Department, so he's nodding his head yes. Next speaker.
Hi, Andrea Parker, Gowanus Canal Conservancy. I very much appreciate the fact that this is all finally starting to wrap up, first of all, to get to a decision, because I think there's a lot more enormous decisions that we're going to have to make in the next however many years that the Superfund process goes on. A couple questions. It's great to have a schedule and a timeline and have a better understanding of how this work's actually going to happen. I do not totally understand why we need 4 years to come up with the design, and that I fear that it is because it's enabling eminent domain instead of allowing an agreement with the property owner.
You're correct. The 4 years is for the ULURP and SECR process to go through, and then to provide a period of time during which the administrative action to make the choice to go into eminent domain is carried out, and the possible litigation at that stage of the game, before eminent domain occurs, that's what the 4-year schedule is there to enable. So yes, you're absolutely right. It's there because of the acquisition process, whether it's a voluntary acquisition, which still requires, in their judgment, the ULURP process, or whether it's an eminent domain, which, however, then also runs the risk of litigation prior to the time the city can actually take title. After that, there's a second possibility for litigation, as I said earlier, but that one doesn't stop the transfer of title.
Okay, well, so since we may have 4 years, I think it would be fantastic if instead of just having the design presented in 4 years, we actually have a robust discussion between now and then about what this tank is going to be like, what the head house is going to be like, and what the open space is going to be like, and who is going to build it, who's going to invest it, and who's going to manage it. And I would echo Sean's comment to have more robust language around actually making open space on top of the tank. Number three,
quick answer to your question there. Yep. The schedule does require the design to be carried out earlier than April 2020. And actually, the first step in the design process, a major step in the design process, has to be completed, for example, by June 30th of 2017. And another major step.
Yeah, but that's the demo, not the design.
No, that's the design package. It requires the demolition, and then, you're correct, then in 2019 is the design package that actually designs the tank, but there are earlier steps along the way towards those design packages. There's a 35% design and a 65% design, so some of the key decisions will be made earlier in the process in order to be able to have the final design done by April of 2019.
Okay,
so you're
great.
Right about the sequence. But there are earlier steps in the process to get us to those endpoints.
Great. Okay. And I mean, I think that the more the community can actually see those schedules, because it seems that they exist, the more comfortable we'll all feel with this. And then finally, I would love to see a similar schedule for the 007 tank. But we'll talk about that tomorrow night.
Thank you. Next speaker. Hi, Dan.
Thank you, Walter. Dan Wiley. Sorry, there's too many things flying in the head. Dan Wiley from Congresswoman Nydia Velasquez's office. I just wanted to acknowledge the statement you made that this is an unprecedented Superfund cleanup record of decision where you had CSO controls as part of the cleanup, which is unprecedented. And I think we should also recognize maybe not the baby step, but the step that the city has taken that had opposed that for years. And I think many in the community are very frustrated with the city for its opposition to the requirement that they actually address the CSOs in a deeper way, that as part of this agreement, they are actually agreeing to do those controls and not challenge those controls. So I just wanted to acknowledge that. I think we all could probably get a master's, if not a PhD, in CERCLA and Superfund law, because every time we come to one of these, we should be getting AP credit for learning new things. And I, in fact, learned a new thing through Katya Kelly's questioning on what about the requirements of what they're putting in the hole that they dig for the tank. And so we learned that there are two species. There's the removal action and there's the remedial action, and that the agreement you have here is something that is an administrative order can deal with removal actions, but remedial actions need judicial consent decree with the U.S. District Court order. So the question is, what's the time frame for that? And obviously the cart can't go before the horse, so the cart has to be finalized, which is this first one. And you also have to get a cart with National Grid. But once the National Grid, I think you said it's a couple of months with National Grid, how long does this judicial consent decree, which I think goes to a lot of the questions that people are asking, is kind of like, it can't answer that question because we're not there yet, even though we're getting there. And the last thing is, no one has said environmental justice, but I do want to acknowledge that the CAG did pass resolutions asking for EPA to do everything in the kitchen sink, and I think we should acknowledge this kind of hard for an agency to be able to keep to its original schedule and address some of the environmental justice concerns about access to open space and amenities for lower income people in developments that rely on this pool. So I think it was a lot to ask EPA to be able to both keep to an original time frame and accommodate people who still need access to these amenities. So I wanted to acknowledge that that might be an impossible thing, but that said, we still want to keep this time frame going as fast as possible.
Thank you, and yes, you all will be keeping our feet to the fire, I have no doubt. I used to call the removal and remedial actions two different flavors of Superfund response action. I'm now calling them two different species. I didn't think flavor was a good word here anymore. Next speaker.
Hi, I'm Lizzie Olesker, O-L-E-S-K-E-R. And I live just a couple blocks away, and I've lived with our canal for many years, like all of us in the community. And I first want to thank you for always being accessible and communicating with us about what's happening. I guess I don't know if I have a question as much as a concern. We're all very wary about the negotiations with the city because they have always, or certainly in the beginning, resisted the EPA cleanup. And finally, we're getting closer and closer. I guess my concern is that you talk about the site at the Thomas Green Park as ideal, as faster, as less expensive, less complicated. And it seems like it was presented to the community like it was either or. You would lose the pool, you'd lose the parkland, but that, in fact, is not the case at all. That park needs to be remediated, that it's highly toxic and polluted, and that remediation is going to happen and go forward, and that the park will be disrupted anyway, and that it will be renovated, remediated, and that the building of the tank what could happen, in fact, in that space that you talked about, that there can be open space once that tank is there. So I guess, and that the pool is inadequate anyway. So I guess my question is, how did this happen? Why are we contemplating another area? I know I'm going backwards to the beginning of the meeting. When we talk about that the city said, no, it can't happen in this park space. And why did that happen? Is it because they're saying, well, we have to retain that park space, when in fact it's going to be disrupted, and that's a good thing because it's highly polluted. And when we talk about environmental justice and trying to protect that land for the people who need it and for that pool that is very necessary. I just kind of go, why is this happening? And it makes me worried. And to go back to that first comment about the process being boondoggled and being postponed and disruption in the EPA process, that's my concern.
Thanks. So it has to do with the length of the disruption and whether or not the placement of a head house in the park would be a permanent loss of it. But I will be at the CAG tomorrow night, and I hope you'll be able to be there and we can talk about it further.
My question is, why not? Like, why is this happening?
Well, again, the answers were the ones that I gave here earlier and that are in the administrative record. You may or may not agree. We will be able to talk about it further tomorrow night, but I want to make sure that we have opportunity for people to make comments now. I also realize I neglected to answer Dan Wiley's question, actually, which is how long the consent decree negotiations, or when they would start and how long they might take. As I said, the negotiations that we anticipate with National Grid, perhaps 4 to 6 months, take us to the third or fourth quarter of this calendar year. And then probably sometime thereafter, we will start on the negotiations for the consent decree. Again, it's going to be extremely complicated, but we hope to have a consent decree in place for the canal portion of the remedy in time for the work on the canal portion of the remedy to start in 2018, I think. Is Christos here? I think he's, is it 2018 that we hope the canal work to actually start, Christos? So again, we hope actually even earlier on the 4th Street Basin for work to start, maybe in 2017, and in 2018 for the head end of the canal area, what we call RTA1 work to begin. We have to have a consent decree in place. If this is going to be done pursuant to a consent decree, which we hope, we have to have that in place before the work actually begins.
Jim Vogel from Senator Montgomery's office. That's V-O-G-E-L. The fact that we're here tonight hearing that there was a lot of Sturm und Drang with the negotiations with the city shouldn't be a surprise to any of us. Think back to all those lovely nights when we would hear Kaz Holloway say, now just suppose, okay? And we're not just supposing anything. With this agreement, it would be nice if it all could get done more quickly. But from what I'm understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, you outlined a series of deadlines, which are the worst possible timetables, not what might actually happen. I don't want to go all Kaz Holloway and say, now just suppose. But we could get lucky on this. But the fact is that you guys have muscled the city into committing to doing more under threat of eminent domain and worse than I can recall anybody having gotten out of the city in the last 25 years. And that's something. It's been a very educational process. Everybody is understandably impatient for it to get underway and to get done for all the reasons that they've all been talking about tonight. Environmental justice is not the least of it. But when I heard the commitment to, first we have to have a place for that pool, you know, I see that all that stuff has been in your calculations. And I fully appreciate that. I mean, it's always an education. That clarification about the purpose of a head house was very useful. But, you know, let's just get going with it, yeah.
Speaker? That's it.
Thank you, everyone, for coming out. I want to just point out a couple of my major items. Number one, the comment period. We are now on record that the comment period has been extended to May 31st. You can send your comments via email to mugden.walter@epa.gov. The comments that you made tonight are part of the record. So if your comment was what you said tonight, you don't necessarily have to resubmit it. In addition, tomorrow night is the monthly community Gowanus Canal Community Advisory Group meeting. It's taking place at the, and I should know this by heart, but I don't, the Mary Star of the Sea Senior Apartments. That's 41 First Street. It's at 6:30 p.m. You will get to see me again. You will get to see Walter again. And I expect to see all of you there tomorrow night. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. Appreciate you coming and your patience.
Oh, one other thing. I just got a card from Anna Chireno, who's a community liaison from Comptroller Scott Stringer's office. So she, of course, heard your comments, and I'm sure will be transmitting it to him. Thank you so much.